decisions. Our next guest says there is global momentum in developing sovereign artificial intelligence and not just borrowing it from hyperscalers. Paul Bloch is co-president, co-founder and president at DDN, a California-based data storage company. Paul, good morning. Great to have you with us. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Juliana. Thanks for having me.
So why does sovereign AI matter so much right now? And perhaps that's a silly question for those who are well acquainted with AI in this entire space, but for those who are perhaps newer or peripheral to the world of AI, talk to us about the significance of sovereign AI specifically.
Sure. So, I mean, again, what we're experiencing now in AI is nothing short of extraordinary, right? So $1 trillion, multi-trillion industry is happening over the next 3, 5, 10 years, right? So first you had the railroads, then you had the internet 20, 30 years ago, right? And at this point you have AI infrastructure. So it's critical for each country to build independence and to be able to create intelligence in their own macro and control that, right? Think about just electricity, right? If you had to buy electricity from other countries, right? You're relying basically on their pricing, their issues, and you're not independent. So the same way in AI, you absolutely need to invest in a country for your defense, security, serving better services to your citizen, for R&D, for medical enhancement. So you really need to basically leverage the ability, and all the value of your country in country and control that.
How difficult is it for places like Europe, places like the UK, to develop their own AI, their own infrastructure, when so much of the innovation has come from the US?
So absolutely. So I think you have to separate almost where you get potentially the base intelligence and what intelligence you're going to create with. So some people believe that it's an issue to actually buy from US provider to create that intelligence. But quite frankly, I don't think you have a choice today. So you really need to take the best of the best in terms of intelligence, and then you actually create this ecosystem in country and start creating your own value, right? So it's really kind of that's the way basically what's happening right now. And then you can use obviously your engineers, your people, and to create that. So it's a, however, what we're seeing is, and then what you need in country, you obviously need land, you need to build massive data centers, right? We're talking gigawatts, to give you an idea to your to people listening. I mean, in just 5-10 years ago, right, thousands of this was already a pretty large system in the computing industry. So a gigawatt is massive, right? It's multi acres of land. It's massive amount of power to feed this. It's water cooling. And then basically you need two platforms. You need NVIDIA for GPUs and networking. And then you need foundation models, inferencing models, and so forth. And then the last part is what we do at DDN, who is a leader in data storage and in an intelligence platform that basically connects to the NVIDIA supercomputer and GPUs and is able to deliver the data, store the data, and really make those systems that cost, you know, tens, hundreds, or billions of dollars much more efficient at scale. And as you see, really what's important is that, yes, the compute at first is super important, but really data is what's going to make, the sovereign AI successful, right? You need the right data feed, but you need the right data sources. You need to be able to mix and have access if you're an enterprise, a company, a university, an organization, or a ministry. You basically need access to all your data, and it is basically very significant and daunting as a task, and that's where DDN helps a lot to accelerate this in the age of AI at any scale.
Paul, let me get your take on NVIDIA, given the relationship DDN has with NVIDIA, your key partner of theirs, as you just described. There's a lot of concern swirling around the interconnectedness of NVIDIA and some of the other key players here, around the circular nature, what some are calling vendor financing, the circular nature of some of these deals that NVIDIA has struck. Should we be worried that we, are entering this sort of convoluted world, what some are calling a Ponzi scheme, basically, where they're basically funding their customers to in turn buy chips from NVIDIA?
So absolutely, right? You can look at it two ways, right? Either this is basically, which has been the case for the past couple of years, every 6 months, what we believe was a frontier in terms of amount of GPUs is basically doubling or going time 10x, right? If you look at it 2 years ago, one of the hyperscaler or foundation model believed that they could basically get to where they wanted to be with 50,000 GPUs. Nowadays, it's 1 million GPUs, right? So there's no doubt basically a growth in the demand. Now, there's a lot of exchange and financing that is happening. And really, it's the goal. What's interesting in the case of Jensen and NVIDIA is that it's really accelerating. So I'm not sure it's a Ponzi scheme. Clearly, there could be a bubble, there could be basically some type of a mini situation of stability, but I don't think it's going to basically crash. It's basically going to might stabilize and then go right back up because AI is here to stay. So I don't believe it's a Ponzi scheme. I think it's a smart way for Jensen to lock in their customers also, to have great relationships, strategic values, and to be able basically to get rewarded both sides, right?
It's certainly creative, and it's proven a smart way so far. When you look at NVIDIA's share price, we're seeing a huge amount of creativity from this industry. What's your take on how long-lasting NVIDIA's moat is going to be? Clearly, it's intact right now, and the market believes it's going to be here for a while. But we also know that, you know, the Chinese are racing to come out with competing advanced chips, and many are, you know, hoping to get a piece of the pie.
Absolutely. So I think the chips is only one side, right? So that's the visible part of the market. I think that NVIDIA has built a massive trove of software. You know, think about all the environment that you need to run those GPUs and make them efficient. And I think NVIDIA is far and away ahead of anybody in that field, right? Compared to all the other guys, AMD, Intel, or even the Chinese. So I think the software is really what's going to make the difference over the next 3-5 years. Although clearly the GPU and basically staying on the race and ahead of the race in GPU is going to be super important. But really, NVIDIA is more than just the GPUs.
When we're talking about sovereign AI, what most determines whether a nation's strategy succeeds or fails, in your view?
I mean, it's longstanding, right? I mean, this is basically a 3, 5, 10-year situation. So countries need to plan, need to basically deploy this infrastructure, get going, get their engineers, get the university researchers, get the government workers, the enterprise, all the core companies in each country to start using AI, to start using agentic AI, to start using reasoning AI. That's the first step. But then really transform all their companies and their processes with AI in terms of the production. So think about the whole core of the company is going to basically evolve and get value out of AI. The ones we're seeing nowadays as your main beings is your chatbot, right? But that's really very much the trivial portion of it. I mean, you can get extract to massive information, massive efficiency. For example, we're talking to a steel company, right? I mean, they were able to literally save 20% of the defects of the, they're buying basically 20 tons, let's say 20 tons of the steel and really wasting 4 tons. At this point, AI is enabling them to be fully efficient. So DDN, the portion of the data side helps a lot lined up with NVIDIA or others.
Where is Europe, in your view, you know, from a policy perspective, in terms of actually driving the sovereign AI? There's a lot of talk about it, but in terms of where they actually are on the ground, what's your take?
So I think basically Europe, France, UK, Germany basically positioned themselves very early as wanting to invest, right? You have massive amount of what they call AI factories and gigafactories plans in Europe announced, in the past 6 to 12 months. You've seen a lot of Macron's ability and talk, Starmer and so forth. But I think it's lagging because at this point, you're getting into typical request for RFPs, government red tape. And I think that that's a mistake. I think that, and obviously there's other economical issues where, spending billions is not seen as positive in certain countries, but I think it's a mistake, right? They should basically embrace it, accelerate it, and get as fast. It's a race. It's absolutely a race. And we're seeing US, China, Korea, for example, doing very well, SoftBank, Japan, and Europe is lagging a bit right now.
Paul, thank you for your time. Really, really great to hear your views. Paul Bloch, co-founder and president, DDN.